We begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Dear Jesus, may the light of your love always shine in our hearts. As Christmas draws closer, we marvel at your great love for us. Let your love transform every aspect of our lives and touch everyone we encounter. Open our hearts to your love this Christmas. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Let us pray. Pour forth, we beseech you, O Lord, your grace into our hearts, that we to whom the incarnation of Christ, your Son, was made known by the message of an angel, may by his passion and cross be brought to the glory of his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the second book of Samuel. When King David was settled in his palace, and the Lord had given him rest from his enemies on every side, he said to Nathan the prophet, "Here I am living in a house of cedar, while the ark of God dwells in a tent." Nathan answered the king, "Go, do whatever you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that night the Lord spoke to Nathan and said, "Go tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, should you build me a house to dwell in? It was I who took you from the pasture and from the care of the flock to be commander of my people Israel. I have been with you wherever you went, and I have destroyed all your enemies before you. And I will make you famous like the great ones of the earth. I will fix a place for my people Israel. I will plant them, so that they may dwell in their place without further disturbance. Neither shall the wicked continue to afflict them as they did of old, since the time I first appointed judges over my people Israel. I will give you rest from all your enemies. The Lord also reveals to you that he will establish a house for you. And when your time comes and you rest with your ancestors, I will raise up your heirs after you, sprung from your loins, and I will make his kingdom firm. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. Your house and your kingdom shall endure forever before me. Your throne shall stand firm forever." The word of the Lord.
Forever.
to David my servant, I will establish your dynasty forever and set up your throne through all ages. Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord, the goodness of the Lord. Happy the people who acclaim such a God, who walk, O Lord, in the light of your face, who find their joy every day in your name, who make your justice the source of your bliss. Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord, the goodness of the Lord. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, to him who can strengthen you, according to my gospel and the proclamation of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery kept secret for long ages, but now manifested through the prophetic writings and according to the command of the eternal God, made known to all nations to bring about the obedience of faith, to the only wise God, through Jesus Christ, be glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
My sisters and brothers, the Lord is with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Good News of Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
The angel Gabriel was sent from God to a town of Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man named Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And coming to her, he said, "Hail, full of grace, the Lord is with you." But she was greatly troubled at what was said and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. Behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son. You shall name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called Son of the Most High God. And the Lord God will give him the house of David, his father, and he will rule over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." But Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I have no relations with a man?" The angel said to her in reply, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age. And this is the sixth month for her who is called barren, for nothing will be impossible for God. Mary said, Behold, I am the handmaid of the Lord. Be it done to me according to your word. Then the angel departed from her. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
A different part of the Christmas story appeals to me every year. I remember the year when it was the visitation of the Magi and the bringing of gifts. I remember the year when it was being born in laid in a manger, born in a stable. So every year a different part of the story has spoken, a different theme has jumped out. This year, it's this story from the Gospel of Luke. I suppose when angels show up, there's an awkwardness, there's a strangeness to it. I look back, there are a lot of citations from the Old Testament and the New Testament where angels are quoted. Abraham is in the desert with Sarah, and three visitors come walking toward them in the book of Genesis. Abraham knows that they're from God, but it's never spoken in the story. He just hops to and sets some servants up to give the finest food for them because hospitality is so important in the ancient Near East and in many of the ancient places of the world. And at the end of the visit, so it's kind of unsaid, like Abraham knows something's going to happen. And at the end of the visit, the three say, by this time next year, Sarah will be pregnant. And Sarah overhears and laughs. And one of the three said, Why did she laugh? And Abraham said, Oh, she didn't laugh. And the one says, Oh, yes, she did. It's sort of ominous, you know. There's just this interaction that's not quite, it's clear, but it's talked about. It's not really elucidated like today's is. There's the angel that appears to Abraham to say, God wants your firstborn. This is the one who's going to start the entire Hebrew nation. God wants your firstborn. And then there is this poignant moment and saving moment when Abraham raises the knife. And the angel shows up and says, God stops your hand. Those are directional. You're getting information. Just like when the angel appears to Joseph around this story, take the child and go to Egypt. There's no dialogue. The angel just says, go. And then after a suitable time, the angel shows up in Egypt, says, it's okay to take the child back. Like a commander, a commandant, do this. What strikes me about today, it is such a tender interaction between Gabriel, the strength of God, the power of God is what Gabriel means. Gabriel appears, and it's not, you're going to do this. It is, greetings, Mary. You are favored by God. You are full of grace. Do not be afraid. That's altogether different from the other angelic stories I quoted. There is, and the conversation continues. There is a respectful, sacred, intimate dialogue. In fact, someone says when the angel shows up to Zechariah and says, your wife Elizabeth's going to get pregnant, and he said, how's this going to happen? He gets struck dumb. Mary says exactly the same thing. There is a difference in the tone. Mary probably more naive and innocent. How's this going to be? Don't worry, nothing's impossible for God. It's just such a beautiful, beautiful interaction. Do a meditation this week as we get to Christmas. Imagine God talking to you like that. When I was growing up, we were so afraid that God was going to show up with a list of demands and a paddle, and guess what? We were all going to catch it. Imagine in your prayer that God shows up and just has this beautiful, tender conversation with you. There's enough in all of our backgrounds to convict us all. And God shows up with exact opposite message. I intend to save you all from your sins. Augustine wrote this, and after, I don't know if Augustine was the first, but his most prominent, and then many mothers and fathers of the church afterwards wrote this. But it seems strange. If I told you Mary conceived in her ear, you'd think I was nuts. But Augustine wrote in the 300s, Mary conceived in her ear. She had to hear the good news first. And then she conceived in her heart. She had to understand and trust. She had to believe. And then Mary conceived in her womb. The action takes place. That's the same for us. For us to follow the Lord, we have to hear it first. And that means a whole lot more today because there are thousands, if not millions, of things that are distracting us. A pandemic. Political upheaval. Sports in the state of Illinois. Believe me, I've had my fill of that. There are distractions out there calling for our attention. We have to conceive in the ear first. It has to be important for us to pray. Help us to hear what you're telling us. And then we too have to conceive in the heart. Is this important for us now that we've heard it? Do I want to believe? Do I want to follow? Do I trust? And once we get to that step, the third, will I act upon it? Will it become incarnate in us and bear fruit in us? Will the love of God, will we show the love of God in our words, in our actions? So just a few days before Christmas, we have been preparing faithfully. And even if we haven't, it's still going to arrive. Do some thinking about a tender conversation between you and God. And also pray for the ability, especially at this point. Would I know the gospel if I saw it or heard it today? Or are there a million of other things on my mind? And if I pray to hear it, will I let it take root in my heart? Will I, in faith and trust, want to follow it? What will it ask me to do? That's the conception in the womb. Being good to the poor. Spending some extra time in quiet. Giving people some attention, as I talked about last weekend. What fruit will we bear at Christmas from having heard, having trusted, having acted? I invite you to profess our faith as we recite the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. We now make known the intentions of our hearts, the intentions of this parish family, to our loving God.
Our response during Advent will be, Come, Lord Jesus, hear our prayer. For the church, that we may continually prepare our own house, growing in holiness as we build the kingdom of God on earth. Come, Lord Jesus, hear our prayer.
Come, Lord Jesus, hear our prayer.
That all nations may reject the use of weapons of war as ways to settle disagreements or assert power, let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus, hear our prayer.
For those who find the holiday season difficult to endure because of loss or loneliness, that they may find comfort and hope in the Incarnation, let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus, hear our prayer.
That the people we touch may see the goodness and generosity of God in our works of charity and compassion, let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus, hear our prayer.
And for all the sick, including the names in our bulletin, let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus, hear our prayer.
For all who have died this past week, especially Margaret and Rocco Consorti, parents of Diane Paulin, let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus, hear our prayer.
For all the intentions of our parish, and especially for Patricia Warzik, for whom today's Mass is offered, let us pray to the Lord.
Come, Lord Jesus, hear our prayer. For everyone in our world, in our nation, in our neighborhood, in our church, let us pray to the Lord. Come, Lord Jesus. Loving God, hear us and help us and hold us close to your heart and prepare our hearts for Christmas. This we pray through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be accepted by our loving God. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of God's name, for our good and the good of all God's holy church. Amen. May the Holy Spirit, O Lord, sanctify these gifts laid upon your altar, just as he filled with his power the womb of the Blessed Virgin Mary. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Children of God, the Lord is with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For all the oracles of the prophets foretold him, the Virgin Mother longed for him with love beyond all telling. John the Baptist sang of his coming and proclaimed his presence when he came. It is by his gift that already we rejoice at the mystery of his nativity, so that he may find us watchful in prayer and exalted in his praise. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we proclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power of working of the Holy Spirit, you gave life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts. These gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, giving the chalice to his disciples, said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the offering of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with the Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God and our Mother of Good Counsel, blessed Joseph, her spouse, your apostles and glorious martyrs, St. Bernard, St. Augustine, St. Rita, St. Monica, St. Thomas of Villanova, St. Nicholas of Tolentine, and all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and the salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, your servant, Francis our Pope, Ron our Bishop, Joseph our Pastor, Alejandro our General, Anthony our Provincial, and all who serve your people. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you, And your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. One mind and one heart, we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our day, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, and you say to us, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer each other a safe sign of peace. My friends, behold the Lamb of God. Behold Jesus, who takes away the sins of the world. How blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ bring us all to everlasting life.
Amen.
Of you viewing this Mass from home, we now offer the prayer of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you in my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Good afternoon, all. Like all of you, we've been busy preparing for Christmas here at the parish. And a couple of reminders. First, reservations for our Christmas masses. We'll close this Wednesday night at 10 o'clock. And I can tell you that the 2 p.m. Mass and the 4 p.m. Mass on Christmas Eve are already full, sold out. No room in the inn. But there's still plenty of seats open at the 9 a.m. Mass Christmas Eve morning and at the 6 p.m. and 10 p.m. Masses on Christmas Eve evening. There's also lots of seats open at the 8:30 and the 12:30 Masses on Christmas Day. The 10:30 Mass on Christmas Day is filling up fast, but there are still some seats available there too. And as I mentioned, we really do not want to turn away anyone at the church doors, but you know, we will if we have to in order to assure a safe environment for all those who have planned to attend. And so if you can, please spread the word that reservations are required to attend our limited seating masses for Christmas this year. Also, for those unable to attend Christmas Mass in church for whatever reason, St. Bernard's has prepared a very nice, high-quality video recording of our parish Christmas Mass. In fact, we held this special Christmas Mass here in church this past Wednesday. And in case you're wondering, that's why the church is decorated for Christmas a little earlier this year, so it would be decorated for the recording. The recorded video includes very beautiful music by Julie and her accompanying musicians with Deacon Kevin and yours truly at the altar. The recorded Christmas Mass will be available for viewing on the parish website or on our parish Facebook page anytime beginning early Christmas Eve morning. And finally, with the holidays this week, reservations for next weekend's Masses on Saturday and Sunday will be open a little longer than usual from this Monday, 9 a.m., until late Christmas Day. And I understand there's still a good amount of płatki available in the foyer. For those of you who observe that tradition, help yourself on the way out.
Let us pray. Having received this pledge of eternal redemption, we pray, Almighty God, that as the feast day of our salvation draws ever nearer, so we may press forward all the more eagerly in the worthy celebration of the mystery of your Son's Nativity, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord is with you.
With
may Almighty God indeed bless us all, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Eucharist is ended. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
At this time, we will dismiss our congregation section by section, row by row. Please wait until your usher comes to your row before moving.